22308, Image API versus Young.
May it please the court, Mr. Greenhill will present argument for the petitioner. Petitioner has reserved 5 minutes for rebuttal.
May it please the court. Section 320705 of the Human Resources Code requires the commission to contract with independent auditors to conduct annual independent external financial and performance audits of its Medicaid contractors. Now, these required statutory audits are one of many interrelated and interdependent safeguards that are in place to make sure that Medicaid contractors are properly paid by the commission.
How do we know this was a statutory audit?
Your Honor, if you look at the audit request, the procurement request from the commission, the internal memo requesting to hire requires the auditor who did this audit, it specifically referenced the statute. The internal, also the communications between the commission and Image API reference an external audit as opposed to, say, the contract audit is what you're referring to. So the contract, the party's contract, Section 805 allows the commission itself to audit Image, and then many contractors, these are discretionary audits that it can conduct whatever it wants to. That's an internal audit. As opposed to,
is there any, would it be a breach of contract if they hired somebody to help them with that?
The contract does not contemplate them hiring somebody to help them with that sort of independent or internal review.
So you think it would be a breach of contract for them to do that?
I don't know that it would be necessarily a breach of contract.
Then why shouldn't we say, even if this isn't a statutory audit, it's a contractual audit, and everybody agreed to that, and so it doesn't really matter what the statute requires?
I don't think there's really any dispute in this case. The audit that we're talking about was a statutory 320705 audit. The memo that the HHCC certainly generally asking to procure services specifically referenced the statute.
But did it also reference the contract?
It referenced the contract to the extent the contract also requires them to conduct these statutory audits. That's part of the statute as well. In Section 16 of the contract, it also states that the party is going to be subject to these independent external financial audits, that these audits are required. And they have to be done timely to ensure the proper payment of Medicaid's funds. And for it to be timely, the legislature told us exactly what that means. It said that these audits must be completed by the end of the year following the year being audited.
Now, why is the requirement that an audit be done now mean that an audit can't also be done later?
And from our briefing, Your Honor, is that just
what? If the statute says the audit has to be done within a year,
right?
Why does that mean another audit cannot be done years later?
So our position is the statutory audits in question are required to be done by the end of the year following the year being audited. Once that time period has expired for a given year, it can't be done. But following, they can always audit us every year after year if it's untimely. And if it's the period of the contract is still in place, they can audit us by a contract. So it's not like they can never audit us again.
But the statute doesn't say you may only audit within this 1 year period, right? It says you must audit in this 1 year period.
And then it says it must be.
And if there's a separate authority for audits, then they can do whatever they want as long as they make sure they do it within the 1 year period prescribed by the legislature. So they can do never ending audits.
That's
as long as they comply with the one the legislature has required them to do.
And that's our point, Your Honor. There's many remedies that the commission has in its arsenal to oversee its contractors. This statutory audit, which is required, is just one of those. And it's required, as long as they do it timely, they can do it. They can use its audit findings to recoup overpayments that are identified by an audit. But if they're barred from doing these audits when the deadline's expired for a given year, they still have other remedies by contract. They still have the ability to, the time period.
Yeah, but my question is, why does the requirement that they do it within a year bar them from also doing it at a different time?
The statutory audits? So because the legislature said they must be completed by the specific time, and if it's not the year that we're talking about, if the time period for that fiscal year, that calendar year, has expired, then the legislature says you can't do them after that. is.
Does the statute provide an independent mechanism to recoup overpayments? Because the contract in this case expired in 2009, right?
It was begun in 2009.
Oh, I thought it expired and then a new one began in 2009. It was 2015.
Yes,
got it. Okay.
And we've since entered into new contracts.
So in 2015. So the question then is, if that doesn't provide an independent mechanism for overpayment, why does it matter whether this is directory or mandatory or even applies?
Right,
Your Honor. There's some separate provision that provides for recoupment.
That's a great point, Your Honor. So our position, of course, is they have these other mechanisms to recoup payments. The contract, for example, specifically says that they can recoup any alleged overpayments that they identify doing an internal audit. The statutory audits do not expressly say that they can use audit findings to recover fees. It's more of an implicit right that they have based on the right given to them by the legislature and the obligation to conduct these statutory audits. So you're right, Your Honor, it's not in there. So we're not asking necessarily for the court to cut off a right that's explicitly given by statute. We're basically asking the court to take away what's an implicit right in the statute.
If there was not 32.07.05D, only B3, would you agree with your friend on the other side?
I would, Your Honor, but there is subsection D.
When was it added to the statute?
It was added a day after subsection B3, so I think the bill was enacted in Part 12 and then later codified in Section 32.07.05, and at first the legislature and the bills had just the subsection B with you have to look and see the contracts and make sure these things are happening and to the extent possible done in a timely manner. And then they later added D. So, of course, they contemplated just having sort of giving the commission leeway to conduct these audits, but then decided, no, we need to give them a hard deadline.
You say D was added one day after B3 was
added? It was added afterward. And I believe it was the day afterward, but I'm not. I'll go back and check.
So, but if it had been added after the events in question, that change the analysis or not?
If it had been added after the change,
I suppose whether or not B3 is there, all the contracting, all the work is done, and then after that year passes, D is added years later. Would that have changed the outcome? Would we still say, no, sorry, it's...
Your Honor, I don't know if the legislature would have put in an application period in the statute saying it applies going forward or applies retroactively, so I'd have to make a determination based on that.
It was just the way it was. They just stuck that in.
They stuck that in there because what they wanted to do, the legislature was not intending with the statute to create a perpetual audit right, which is what the commission believes it has. It was trying to make sure the commission was complying with its obligation to oversee its Medicaid contractors to ensure the payments are being properly spent.
What's the point of, if they're enacted close in time, saying, well, just be as timely as you can, and then saying, but it must be finished by the end?
So the way I read the two together is that, so you look at subsection B, and it's telling the legislature sort of how it has to oversee these independent auditors that it hires. It says, you know, for example, you've got to make sure the audit procedures are consistent, and to the extent that there's a risky contract, maybe you audit it more than once a year. And then you oversee these contractors or the auditors and say, make sure they're done timely, and because subsection D then tells you exactly what that means. They must be completed by the end of the year following the year being audited. And so this gets into actually a good canon of construction that we cited in our brief. Justice Scalia's opinion, or the opinion in the Nielsen case, which the court cited in Stetson, was you can't read two provisions in the same statute to be redundant. So B3 and D are both just telling the commission that they just have to try hard. To get it done on time, then they'd be redundant. You can't read it like that. B3 is telling them what they need to do when they're overseeing these independent auditors, and D is telling them when it has to be done, when it must be completed.
The commission alternatively argues that your client is not a Medicaid contractor because the tasks assigned in the contract are not of the nature that are contemplated to be administrative services in relation to the operation of Medicaid.
They do, Your Honor. And I think they throw grossly mischaracterize what we do. It's actually a very complex procedure. We are the funnel for all of the commission's mail, Medicaid, SNAP programs. It all comes to us. Medicaid is by far the largest bit of mail we get. And so we get all their correspondence. This has to do with Medicaid applications. This has to do with correspondence that's gone out for Medicaid saying, hey, your application is missing a driver's license copy. Please send it back. The copy comes back. So we get all of that. We've had trained professionals who open this mail, categorize it, determine what it is, barcode it, and scan it so they can get to the proper places in the commission. And so the administrative services being referred to in the statute, we think they mean it's just it's a ministerial type of service that helps the commission do its job. But even if there was some sort of managerial component in it, we do that too. We have to hire these people. We have to train them. They have to make decisions on what kind of correspondence or application it says and where it's going to go.
But don't you have to look at the examples that are given us, such as examples, to decide what administrative means?
I don't think so, Your Honor. I think the examples that are provided are
well, it needs to be of the same kind of class as that, right?
No, Your Honor. Generous. Your Honor, the specific services that are being referenced, of course, are defining Medicaid's, the Commission's operation of Medicaid, not the administrative services that need to be done. But even if you extended it beyond that and said it also referred to the administrative services, we do that too. The statute says.
One of those things would you say most closely approximate what you do? Claims processing, utilization review.
Client enrollment, Your Honor.
So you're making a decision on enrollment.
So what we're doing, we're the front end of the eligibility determination process. Without what Image does, nobody can be eligible, deemed eligible to enroll in Medicaid.
Are you rejecting anybody?
No, we're not rejecting anybody. Here.
Okay. Well, that seems like an enrollment decision is whether you get enrolled or not.
Well, don't forget, Your Honor, these are related to these specific tasks. So client eligibility determinations are certainly related to client enrollment. We are providing support for the commission in enrolling clients into the program. But really, Your Honor, the point I want to make is this deadline, this audit deadline, by which it must be completed, is mandatory, and it has a logically necessary consequence. The court has said, of course, you will read a statute, a deadline, as directory when there's no explicit consequence, but if there's a logically necessary consequence for noncompliance, you will apply the statute. And we submit that the logically necessary consequence for missing the deadline is the loss of the authority. The loss of the authority to conduct the audit the statute gives them, and then the inability to use any findings from those untimely audits as a method to recover alleged overpayments.
That second part of what you said is I think, the most difficult part for you, right? That the necessary consequence of the audit deadline expiring is that even if improper payments are discovered later, they cannot be recouped. And if you might expect that the legislature is going to, you know, give up its right to recoup improperly paid taxpayer money, that, you know, it would be expressed a little bit differently than just, you know, having to be implied from this deadline where no consequence is stated.
So you look at the statute's purpose, right, and then the overall purpose, of course, is to provide medical assistance to Texans who need it. And the way to do that is to ensure the proper payment of Medicaid funds, billions of dollars in Medicaid funds. And so we would acknowledge that, yes, they might, in these certain situations when they're not doing their obligation of conducting these annual audits, there might be some amount of money that would have to be forfeited, a small amount, and the audit might find nothing. But the amount of money that's going to be recovered if the commission is required to do these audits timely, as it's supposed to do, far outweighs that amount. So what we're proposing serves the statute's purpose. What the commission is proposing, that it has a perpetual audit right to come back 50 years later and audit somebody who used to be a Medicaid contractor.
Was the audit resisted in any way?
No, not this year on the audit.
That might be the distinction, right? If the party's position is you can't audit me, then perhaps it does have some recourse to resist the audit. Whereas if the audit takes place and irregularities are discovered, the consequence that the state cannot collect money that is rightfully its. That's an additional consequence of the ultra vires nature of the audit.
Your Honor, we believe that they cannot conduct the audit, but what the commission has done is come in and say, if you don't come in and say, we want to conduct an untimely statutory audit, and if you don't submit to it, we think you're in breach of the contract because the contract requires compliance. Even if the contract that issues expired, they think they can force us to comply with this untimely audit because the contract says we have to comply.
Why wouldn't the reason, why wouldn't you be able to contest the amount of the overcharge found by the audit by saying the audit was untimely, so in particular, unsupported labor cost. So you found X amount of dollars in unsupported labor costs. If the audit had been conducted timely, that would not be a stale claim, and we would have had more capability of providing the documentation, the necessary documentation to support it. Why isn't it just going to the mix of about whether the amount of overcharge is reasonable?
So, Your Honor, would you take the position that the findings are void because the audit was untimely? But to your point that, I'm sorry, I'm...
Why is it just the untimeliness prevented us from providing the necessary documentation in these categories, and as a result, your imposition of $440,000 in overcharges is unreasonable?
The audit didn't prevent us from providing the documentation.
Okay, so the overcharge, you're not saying that the audit was stale, we weren't able to comply with some of the requirements?
No, we don't dispute the specific audit findings from the 2016 audit. What we're saying is you can't actually audit us after the deadline's expired or use any findings.
But you don't contest the findings themselves?
No, Your Honor.
Okay.
But I guess what Justice Blackhawk was asking is why should this be like, it almost sounds like you're arguing that what was uncovered in the audit is fruit of the poisonous tree or, kind of like a criminal law exclusionary rule.
Sure.
But once you find this evidence, if you didn't contest the audit, you don't have to. You can still exclude the evidence from consideration later.
So, Your Honor, I want to lay to rest any thought that this is sort of fruit of the poisonous tree. These were minor invoicing errors. And our position is we want the timely audit so these things can be caught. We operate under what's called a retrospective cost settlement model, where the commission pays us a fixed fee on a monthly basis, then we go back.
But you are asking that they not be able to rely on any of the information that was obtained in the audit, even though you didn't resist the audit.
We didn't resist the audit because they told us they were going to breach the contract if we did. And so the point of the timely audit, we want them to audit us timely so that we can uncover these invoicing errors and going forward correct them in an effort to save the public money.
Any other questions? Thank you, Mr. Greenhill.
May it please the court, Mr. Cuenin will present argument for the respondent.
May it please the court. So, consequences. Section 32.0705D has no judicially enforceable consequences that a court could adjudicate an ultra vires claim. But we don't think the court has to reach that issue for the reasons we briefed in part one of our brief.
Well, let me see. You seem to argue that it's your belief that the audits were conducted under the contract rather than the statute. So what is your authority for that?
Your Honor, I would, I'm referencing that this was Defendant's Exhibit 4 from the hearing below. This would have been the volume of the reporter's record beginning at page 133 to the beginning of the party's contract that discusses the legal authority for entering into the contract in the first place. This is undisputed. There's several provisions of the government code, the health and safety code, that it moves in several pages later to discussing the audit requirements, and specifically under 803, this is page, this was PDF page 141, it's a provision in here that says upon notice from HHSC, contract will provide, et cetera, such auditors and inspectors as HHSC may from time to time designate. That sort of goes on with it. There's also recruitment, as my friend on the other side discussed in section 9 of this contract. And then if we go to section 11.11, there's a number of provisions that discuss dispute resolution. So I think putting all of that together, I may have glossed over this, but the 7-year sort of record retention cap that was part of the party's contract, that in that time, I think Image API has a hard time explaining why it would not expect to be subject to.
Well, the other side says the notice said this was just an audit under the statute and not under the contract, so all of the statutory provisions would apply and the restrictions as well. So what's your response to that?
A couple. I believe the specific document that Image API referenced in the podium a little while ago, as I read it, it referenced several vendors. Image API may be discussed as one of them. And the other thing that I would note is there was a box in the contract for the statutory provision. It was the pre-codification, and this exact statutory citation escapes me at the moment, but it was not selected. Putting that aside, even accepting Image API's current argument, which I don't believe even arose until after the auditor identified over $1 million of overpayments, and only then did it decide to assert defensively this notion that something in 32.0705 meant that, as your auditor referenced, the findings were through the poison tree, for lack of a better term, and just couldn't be used to recoup funds against them. That's what that arose. And I think under this court's precedent, for that to be the reading of the statute that's required, we expect the legislature to have said so very clearly, either explicitly imposing some consequences or necessarily putting them there by implication.
If there were no question that the audit was being conducted purely under this statute that requires it to be done within a year, might a party in this situation be able to bring an ultra-virus claim to prevent the ongoing conduct of a audit that's beyond your authority?
It's an interesting question because Your Honor phrased it in terms of ultra-virus, and part of the reason we're arguing that here is because of this declaratory judgment type posture. The party's contract provides for contested case proceedings in 11.11, as I referenced earlier, and presumably we would be making similar types of arguments for why 32.0705D is directory versus mandatory, but I'm not sure that it would be phrased in terms of the ultra-virus doctrine that comes up here because we're in this jurisdiction type posture. So,
it seems that the statute says you have to do it within a year, and if you try to do it after a year, it seems to me they'd have a pretty reasonable claim to get a court to stop you from doing it after your authority to do it has expired.
And I think that would be their argument in such a case.
Obviously, in this case, it's complicated by the contract and by other considerations, but just purely under the statute, I don't see why this isn't a mandatory requirement that could be enforced by a court. And then the separate question is whether you have this fruit of the poison tree consequence.
Well, I want to turn directly to, it sounds like now we're talking about the substance of the argument. Is it directory or mandatory? In other words,
it seems to be that that's a distraction, right? Whether it's directory or mandatory, the question is, it obviously requires them to do something by a certain period of time, which is mandatory. The question is, what's the consequence?
If Your Honor is
the debate ought to be over whether the consequence is this fruit of the poison tree issue or not, as opposed to whether we put the mandatory or directory label on it, which is, I think, kind of a sideshow.
I agree wholeheartedly that what's doing the work is not the label directory versus mandatory. What matters, what does the work in these types of cases, as the court recognized most recently in Stetson, it's a consequence. Cases like this come down to consequences. Of all the possible consequences that could be out there for something not happening on a particular timeline, did the legislature explicitly or implicitly tell courts what consequence to impose? That's the question. And here, the parties agree there's no explicit consequence whatsoever. The Court of Appeals correctly noted that as well. That part of the case is over and done with. It's a case instead about, is there some necessarily implied consequence in 32.0705D? And I would submit that there's not. My friend on the other side did suggest at least one consequence. So one consequence could be this fruit of the poison tree concept, where you just cannot use the findings of the audit retrospectively. Now, I really...
One consequence could be if you resist the audit, then you're able to do that and get a court to stop it if you're just relying on the statute. And if you don't avail yourself of that opportunity, you've waived it.
I think there could be a number of consequences from something like that, Your Honor. All the way to ones that were discussed in Inri Stetsit, where it's really not courts that are stepping in. Rather, what statute is speaking to is the HHSC folks and telling them, well, these audits were not performed on a certain timeline. Maybe you need to find a new external auditor. Maybe you need to go back to the legislature. Maybe there need to be hearings and legislative findings. Maybe the legislature needs to explain at that point what it should do. But this is where I think the court has repeatedly noted separation of powers doctrine comes in, because to select among these potential consequences means that unless there is some very clear textual commitment to one consequence versus another, then it becomes a court that is making that policy choice.
Stetson wasn't rid of the problem that we had two competing statutory goals. One was to process these things in a particular fashion. One was this program is going to come to an end at the stroke of midnight on a given day. And for the court to choose either to extend a program that the legislature has chosen not to extend, or to try to order somehow magically the controller with limited resources to do something that was not feasible when he's in triage mode, the courts had no basis to choose among these and to discern any particular legislative directive what the consequence would be. Here we don't really have that, do we? It's just a matter of do this by this time. You didn't do it. Later, I guess, even in the prior case, 43 months for service. And here we had your colleague from the offices of general say the word must create this condition precedent. And here in the very next case, we have the state going further beyond that period of time and saying, don't worry about it. Don't worry about the word shall. Don't worry about the word must. It's a little discordant when there's not something else that is inconsistent as there was in Stetson. That's the concern I have.
I think our arguments are consistent in terms of what must and shall mean. What I'm saying is that there is that discordance here, and I can point to it in B, just above D, that we've been discussing so far. We've been mostly focused on D. But B seems to have an explicit acknowledgement from the legislature that from time to time there will be untimely audits, that from time to time in B3, we'll have situations we have to discuss whether, to the extent possible, audits under this section are completed in a timely manner. And so I think
you mentioned 7 years requirement to keep necessary documentation for 7 years. If HHSC had instigated the audit 25 years from now, would your position still be the same, that the audit results are what they are and they don't lack any veracity or and nothing about them because they're so stale means you can't recoup?
I imagine that in that scenario, I could see different arguments being made. All I can really say now is that the legislature didn't put that type of time limit. But I want to point out that
have the statute of limitations in connection with the contract, presumably.
Presumably. But also, I think this is important to note that as a vendor like Image API, they're subject to sorts of audits. And this is sort of a little bit beyond the scope of the briefing, but there are a number of federal audits. There are other types of... the universe of audits is fairly nebulous. So this idea that a vendor like Image API is simply put upon by audits is... I think it's a little hard to make that argument.
Well, maybe not put upon by audits, but depending on what the reasoning behind failure to comply with labor supporting documentation for labor costs. If it's something that is easily correctable, had they known that the auditor would say, oh, your paperwork is missing this piece of information, if you wait, you know, well beyond the time of the statute to inform them of this deficiency, that's a problem.
I think I understand. I think my response would be those are the types of arguments we would expect to see a vendor make in like a contested case setting that the contract provides for dispute resolution, rather than saying that the HHSC commissioner violated some ministerial consequence.
So your answer is they could contest the amount of the overcharge based on deficiencies in the audit, including the timeliness of the audit.
I assume so, but Image API has not made that argument in this case. So what they have focused on is the consequence. They say there's a consequence for failing to meet a timeline, and it just has no hook to the statutory text whatsoever. It could be one consequence, but the text is very important. There's a part that was left out when Image API made its argument a minute ago about the difference in the statutes, right? Adding D, when did D get added? The relevant question is not on what date D got added. It's what else did the legislature add at the same time? Here's what it added, the word annual. The legislature added the word annual in B. Changed the phrase from simply external audits to external annual audits. And at the same time added D. So I think the most natural reading of those phrases in context, B and D together, is if you're going to require external annual audits, you would expect the legislature to explain what it meant by an annual audit in that sense. So that
D3 and D both just refer to audits under the section. To the extent possible, audits under the section are completed in a timely manner. And then D, an audit required by the section, must be completed before the end of the fiscal year. Why could you not harmonize them in this way, saying that D3 is saying an audit is required in this section? We want it to be timely. We want it to be quick. All the stuff that Justice Byrne was just talking about. If you've got some problem with this particular form, we need to get that resolved ASAP so that we don't have more and more. And then D says, but whatever else, even though you really ought to have done this by March, that would be timely, but the end of December is the drop dead. How is that not a proper harmonization of these two?
So I think maybe that is one way to harmonize those statutes, but what the court's precedent would ask at that point is what are the consequences of doing so? Is this something that does harm to the purpose of the statute? So if you adopt that reading to harmonize them, now you run into problems with B1 and B2, which seems to suggest that the frequency of audits is not always ratcheted up to 11 for every vendor for all purposes. And then for 2, that audits are used consistently, the word consistently was chosen. You may not know whether consistency has been achieved going into it. It may only become apparent after the fact. And that's another critical problem with Image API's argument, is that what they are saying, effectively, that you cannot go back in time after this, what they call the one-year deadline, you cannot go back and recoup funds, really have not grappled with what that might mean for state Medicaid system. Because
are you saying the word annual in B before you get to B1 is itself suggesting that the statute is contemplating things that go well beyond that it itself is contemplating audits that might be multiple years prior?
It could, and I mean, it may seem a little silly to think the word annual needs definition, but I think in this context, it's area.
Sort of like administrative services.
Well, I'm happy to shift to that part of the argument next. But
does the commission argue that it could contract for audits differently than the statute? Could it have a provision in the contract, regardless of what 32705 means, we can conduct audits whenever we feel like it, as long as it takes, irrespective of the statute? Or does the statute limit?
Well, we do not believe that we were limited to this statute in the audit in the first place. This was an argument that Image API came up with after the fact.
So what's the purpose of the statute?
So the purpose of the statute,
do anything you want.
Well, the purpose of the statute is to ensure it can in B2 a certain level of consistency, that the frequency of the audits in B1 matches the level of risk to the state. I would think of it as sort of a baseline expectation.
But to me, your argument is, well, maybe we might do that if we wanted to, but we can contract for anything, and we can do anything, irrespective of the statute.
And I would expect that if the parties had a dispute about that, it might come up in a contested case proceeding. But the reason we can't really accept the limit that Image API is suggesting here is because the federal government is at one point, maybe after this timeline, come and say, we've audited the state in some way. There's going to be money that needs to be recouped. I mean, the consequence of not then being able to properly recoup public funds that could toll in the hundreds of millions, if not billions of dollars, if after the timeline, either A, it's just not apparent during this window the legislature gave that there's been misuse or overpayment of funds. I mean, it would be really damaging to the purpose of protecting the public fisc if a party could simply just slide under the radar for long enough, say, I made it past D, I'm untouchable now. Well, that money's public money, nevertheless, and it's going to have to be paid if at some point.
Why doesn't your construction render subsection D meaningless and superfluous such that the section would bear the exact same meaning if D was not in there at all?
So, to my earlier point, it does serve a purpose, right? You're going to tell, if you're HHSC, you hire the external auditor, you say, this is what annual audit means, give us one of these. It's definitional in that sense. And audit,
not D, though.
D is explaining what annual means in the context of annual. Because it could mean do an audit within the same calendar year. It could mean plan year. It could mean compensation year based on how often a vendor is being paid. Annual audits could have a couple meanings. This just gives some clarity for what the baseline expectation is.
He doesn't talk about annual audits. He talks about audit required by this section.
And if the court is inclined to just read D, I think the case becomes even easier than I've discussed so far.
I don't think we're just going to read D, we're reading the whole thing. And Justice Boyd's point is one that's troubling me as well. I guess D is kind of like a little best practices guide. The legislature is giving some helpful hints to the commission. Hey, this might be good to do this by the end of the next year. Of course, you don't have to. You're the commission. But
well, we take the position that, like the court noted in Stetson, that what the legislature enacts it is the law and needs to be followed. The question is consequences. And what is
the point is, without a consequence, D does nothing. D, we can just take our eraser and take D completely out of the section. And this, the effect and meaning of the section is identical with or without.
And I would say if it seems that way, I think it's because B itself, right, is the only part of the statute that even arguably requires an audit under a particular timeline. It is a directory command nested within another directory command.
And one way to enforce it is to object to the audit. Right? We talked about this earlier.
Right.
And that would be a way to give meaning to D to say, okay, if you think it's outside the time, then object to it. The consequence is not necessarily going to be excluding the evidence that you get as well.
I see my time's expired. I think that's right, Justice Quisby. And if there's some dispute over whether there are additional consequences, it's really for the legislature to decide that as a matter of its prerogative to make those policy choices.
I want to be sure I understand your jurisdictional position because you've asserted immunity here, but I think it's trying to collect this overcharge. Are you doing that in a contested case hearing? And it seems strange to assert immunity when you want money from them.
So the very short answer is that actual recruitment part of it is just—it's not part of this case. They sued us in this fashion to say you can't.
But why didn't you say, "Darn right, I want my money"?
I just supposed to be—I have not given
I have not given a thought to the exact procedural posture of it. I took Image API's statement at its word that in this case it is not challenging or disputing the substantive findings of the audits. I took them at their word.
So the commissioner doesn't want them out.
I did not mean to suggest that.
Well, what's the consequence of all this going to be if you win and we dismiss? I mean, if we say there's no jurisdiction, we're going to dismiss without prejudice. There won't be any res judicata or anything from anything we say in this case, in the contested case hearing.
Well, I think there's... My time has expired. I think you
may answer the question.
You'd have to... We'd have to wait and see what they argue in a contested case hearing.
And we're just wasting our time, basically.
Well, there's the other issue that, you know, I'm happy to stand on the papers for it, but in part one, that this is not a party that's covered by that section of the 32.07.
I'm sorry, Chief, I didn't ask my question. Is there some practical reason why HHSC really doesn't want this to be labeled administrative services? The movement costs a kind of problem. It's sort of Alice in Wonderland if this is not an administrative service, but is there some reason why you're pressing that position?
It's that distinction that between sort of substance that the legislature gave.
No, I mean a practical reason for HHSC why it would be, you know, horrific for this to be considered an administrative service.
And I think Image API is just one example of people who would come out of the woodwork and say, I'm a contractor, and then under Image API's theory have to be subject to these audits. There's a consequence to that, certainly to adding to the burden of entities out there that now are covered by certain statutory requirements or what have you. But that's going to add to the state's burden, the state's cost, public fisc.
I have one last thing, Chief, just briefly with respect to the Chief Justice's question about what the statute binds you to do vis-a-vis contracts. And I think you said you could contractually agree to do a lot more of these or a longer period of time. Could you do the opposite? Could you contractually agree with some very desirable Medicaid contractor, suing their Medicaid contractor, to not do one? Or would the statute prohibit that?
So that, I think, is... It's a closer question. I would approach it the same way the court has in AC interests and Stetson, and look at if the statutory floor has been breached, is there a consequence that's expressly or impliedly stated by the legislature? And I don't think this is a case where that has even arguably happened, but even if it did, even in that case, there's not that type of consequence that's judicially enforceable. It would be a policy choice at that point. That's for the legislature.
That's the thing. I'm wondering, even if you didn't have a contract, if you didn't do it, that seems more like the situation in Stetson. Nobody could come in and demand that you do it. But when there is a statutory directive, maybe you look past it and then seek to presumably implicate at some point the judiciary in enforcing that. That seems like a very different situation. It can't be like we were in Stetson. Like I say, this is not our ballgame. We're not in this. This is for them to find out. But once you do something where you purport to force against somebody, some inaction is quite different from delayed action. I'm wondering. That's my last thing.
It's hard for to my eye. I have a hard time drawing that distinction on this statute where B3 has an explicit contemplation that there are going to be untimely audits. The legislature is aware of that.
Any other questions? Thank you, counsel. Mr. Greenhill, you have 5 minutes. And I thought I heard you say earlier that there are other ways for the commission to get the money back. But I didn't hear a list.
So, if there's a given year that the commission wants to audit, say we're within the contract term, and the deadline for the statutory required annual statutory audit has expired, if the contract is still in place, they have the ability to audit us under the contract and recover any alleged overpayments identified in those internal audits. And they also have the ability to have the state auditor's office audit us under 806 of the contract. So there's ways in place for even if the statutory deadline is expired, when the contract is still in place, they have the ability to come back and audit us under the contract and recover. have to do these audits. They are required to do these audits under the statute, and that's what they invoked in this specific situation. They could do one under the contract, but they're also always required to do one under the statute as well. It's the final bookend process of sort of this annual closeout, right?
Yes, I'm asking, why can't it be both?
Why can't it be both?
Because why can't we say we're auditing you under the statute and also under the contract?
They can do both. They're just required to do the statute. They're not required to do the contract audit. And in this instance of the contract audit, they don't hire an independent auditor to do it as they do with the statutory audit. They hire an external company to come in and take a look at the books.
Well, I guess what I'm asking is, why couldn't they say at the beginning of this audit, we're going to conduct this audit this way, and we're going to deem it to be under the statute and under the contract?
Could they make it, if they hired an independent company, I don't know if the contract contemplates them having an independent auditor do the contract audit.
Well, so he said it says something about that agents that we shall designate from time to time, something like that in the contract. So could you designate an outside person as the agent for purposes of the contractual audit?
The contract says you have to contract with the independent auditor, so I don't know if designating them would satisfy that requirement. I think that you've got the contract audit, you've got the statutory audit, so they're two things, and the deadline for the statutory audit cuts off, and what we're saying, I want to clarify what we're saying, is the ultimate relief we want is that the commission can't do these audits. The consequence we seek is that they can't do these audits, so whether or not that there's any findings from an untimely audit that you can't recoup, it's really beside the point. We don't think they can do them, period, and we've prevented them from doing them in recent years as opposed to the ones that we're talking about.
How do you do that?
We've just told them that it's untimely and they can't do it. And also, I want to clear up one point about the...
Did they just say okay? They said okay.
I think because this litigation is happening, there's a bond in place that prevents them from enforcing the trial court's judgment. And so I do...
So that's why they're not seeking to recover that.
Well, so what happened with the recovery of money, and I want to make this clear, is they sent us a demand letter and said, pay us this money. And we said, no, the audit is untimely. At that point, they said they're going to withhold payments from our invoices. And at that point, it's when we filed a lawsuit and said, no, the audit is untimely. And then they said, well, we want to refer this to the State Office of Administrative Hearings. And then they never did it. They sat on that for a couple of years, and we finally reasserted our lawsuit. And that's how we got where we are today.
And so they don't have to go to SOA. They can just withhold your funds, and then you can try to sue them. But they say you can't sue them.
Under the contract, they can't withhold our funds. That's the position we're taking.
Right, but if they do, then they say, well, you can't sue us.
Right, and so, yeah.
So basically, they don't need to go to SOA.
Right.
Okay.
So
if there was one of these audits that was untimely, and for the technical reasons you say, it can't be deemed to be the contractual one, but they get all the things and you're not contesting the $440,000 finding, all this stuff. So if they say, all right, fine, now we'll do it the contractual way, what would be the point of that? You know you haven't contested it. You know what the result will be.
Yeah, so that's our point, is why can't they conduct, they have other remedies, so why can't they do these statutory audits timely? There's no burden on their part to go out and contract with an independent auditor to do this.
But you can see that there is no, that the statute has no way of constraining the contract. So the statute says it must be done by this year, and that in no way limits the ability of a contract to go beyond that and do all sorts of other things.
Right, as long as the contract is still in place, they have the ability to audit us under the contract. And just real quickly, the 7-year document retention policy that I referred to, that isn't a deadline for conducting statutory audits. That's just a document retention policy that contemplates that if there's any suspect that one of their contractors perhaps engaged in some sort of foul play earlier in the contract, we hold these documents so they can look at them, because it specifically references litigation. But ultimately, the point I want to make is the logically necessary consequence for blowing by the deadline is that they can't do the audit. And so we'd like the court to render judgment on our declaration that the untimely audit cannot be done.
Any other questions?
If you have gone to SOA, if you wanted to, when they said we're going to withhold the funds instead of suing, could you have gone to SOA under the dispute resolution provisions of the contract?
Your Honor, I believe it's the commission's has the ability to go to SOA.
Or could you have gone somewhere else under the contract? Under the dispute resolution provisions of the contract, or are they one? one side, they say if the state has a dispute, they can go this way, but you have no remedy.
Your Honor, I believe it's the commission that has the ability to go to SOA. I don't know that we have the ability to do that as well. Your Honor, I'm not sure of your question. I can follow up with you on that if you'd like.
I can look at it.
Any other questions?